got.
Yeah,
okay. Well, I'm Martin O'Neill. I'm a freelance illustrator or graphic artist or experimental analog man now dragged into a digital world. My moniker, or whatever you call it, is Cut Out Studio, so you can follow, like, and subscribe or whatever to my world. As Griff said, kind of illustrators and animators spend millions of hours on your own, and it's quite weird to all of a sudden stand in front of a load of people and kind of have a therapy session. It is quite confusing talking about how, why, and what. But the talk is in kind of four or five sections. One is just sort of a quick idea of how I kind of discovered my aesthetic, my style, my kind of what I was passionate about. I was accidentally became obsessed with a kind of whole realm of handmade. I'm going to talk about that, and then I'm going to talk about commercial collage, how I became a commercial collage artist, and all of the jobs in there. It's about 15 slides, just quickly going through, really try and keep things moving, keep moving it on, try to do typography. If I'd have, I wasn't trained in typography, I wasn't trained in illustration, but I'm kind of really keen to try and apply new ways of collage into different commercial jobs. That's the second bit. Third bit is kind of taking a few projects apart to show how particular ideas developed, and showing that your initial idea, what you think in your head, isn't essentially going to be the best route. So I've got three of those. I'm going to talk about the studio for a bit. The actual kind of, it's kind of an odd studio has become a kind of brain that I walk into in the morning, and it does a lot of thinking for me. So just sort of kind of studio as something that feeds the practice, and the practice feeds the studio. And then lastly, experiments, very short moving image experiments that I was kind of doing before me and Griff evolved to be these collage animating duo. So kind of my whole sort of invented practice, I sort of invented a career that by slowly just sort of plugging away, but is analog essentially. So most of the work you'll see is either analog based, but I do like to get things out of the computer before cutting them up and sort of reappropriating them and then putting them back in. So I was looking at the first part, is sort of this journey to college, but I was looking at, I've just pulled out all old stuff before I left the studio, and I found this illustration when I was about 11 years old at junior school, and I just went, wow, it's pure decoration. That is as decoration as you can get. I was obviously got really obsessed doing it, very excited, just doing this woven stuff. I almost remember the time doing something like that, I got a gold star. I think that's what, you were all here because some teacher went, wow, that's good, at art school, or GCSE, or whatever, all that kind of stuff. So this does come in later on, and I've got this theory that you have all your ideas inside you, you just need to dig about and find them, but you've already got the solution to the problems that come up for you, but they're kind of there, but you just got to dig about and find them. So I did a GCSE, A-level foundation course, and then got to a degree in printmaking at Leeds. It was a graphic design course, but it was specialised in printmaking. And at the end of the first year, luckily got this three-month trip to an art college in southern Germany, the edge of the Black Forest, a really odd small town. We kind of just went there for 3 months, and the art college shut for 9 weeks, so I was wandering around the town not knowing what to do. And this was the kind of work I was doing. I was sort of doing reportage, just collecting information, just drawing out in the streets, being cold, drinking way too much beer, and sort of becoming a bit of a local. The art students had kind of left as well because it was closed. But I wandered out of town after about 3 weeks into this 3 months, and I found this paper dump. And it was like an epiphany. Maybe because it was German paper and stuff, was everything was in a foreign language, it just looked interesting, it looked different. I didn't know what the words meant, so the type became graphics and shapes. And I ended up going daily and collecting carry bags of this stuff, and just sort of became obsessed with collecting it. I didn't even know what to do with it, but there was a romance to this stuff. And when I brought it back often, it didn't look very interesting. it dried out. So I kind of invented ways of making the cardboard look damp again because it was more translucent. So I had a little bucket of oil, add inks and stains. So this was my kind of work out in, along with this very traditional drawing and writing about what I was seeing. So this kind of stuff, I spent the rest of the time there, the 3 months. I got in trouble with some of the tutors at the German college because they were like, where did you get this stuff? Some of this stuff is secret documents. And other tutors were like, this is brilliant, just keep collecting it. And I started to, as I was sticking it in every night, sort of on my own, I'm that old, it was before the internet, so I was in this small sort of town in my own flat. The girl wearing the flat was back in my dungeon in Leeds. And so I had all this stuff, sketchbooks and stuff, and I couldn't even talk about what it was about. And I went back to Leeds with a suitcase full of rubbish and sketchbooks full of this stuff and pulled it all out, and they were like, brilliant, it's great, but what does this all mean though? And I was just forever embarrassed and awkward and sort of stuck in crypts. I didn't have any ideas, but I was building an aesthetic. I was learning how to put found images, textures, paper and paint together manually. There was not really a lot of other. The computers were just arriving in college about this time. It's like 92, I was 20. And so this stuff, anyway, back at college, I was really encouraged, but I started mixing silkscreen printing on top of it, colour copying that, re-silkscreen printing on top of it, and I kind of just developed a way of working, but it was kind of like, it was bizarre. We were doing etching on a graphic design degree, so it was really odd. I'd get briefs for graphic design, but answer them in silkscreen collage. So it was quite a really good course that let me cross-pollinate. So last week of the whole course, someone said, you should go to the illustration department. You could be an illustrator. So I went up and chatted to this amazing illustrator who's part-time teaching called Joe Hassel. Showed all this stuff and she went, right, go and see Tomato, Versace, Penguin. Go and see all these people with your... And I had this sort of clumpy folio of... Again, I wasn't an illustrator and I couldn't talk about this stuff in crits. A very intelligent friend of mine used to drop in and speak for me and say, well, the idea is about the selection, what you selected and what you put together and what you left behind. And it's just creating sort of beautiful moments. So I'm sort of advertising to be an illustrator with this kind of stuff. And this was the first set of work I put in a book called Contact, which cost like 800 quid to have a page in. But I instantly got some really, loads of people wanted to use my work, but they didn't know how to. Because it was just raw and yeah, that successful little collages, but again, I had no real, am I just creating, is it just decorative or what's the story? So I struggled in the first couple of years to get work and book covers and for one, find a red chess piece before the internet. So I had to go to a library, actually found out that you could write to Christie's and ask them for back catalogues of professional chess sets, beautifully photographed, ancient stuff. A couple of quid and they'd send you. So that was a really good research tool. 25 years of doing things like that, I'll show you the studio a bit later, it's a bit wrong, a bit mental. But this is one of my first commissions and things had to be correct and I had to go to a shop to find vintage Russian money. And I'm not going to talk about how sort of slow things were back then, where you would take a photocopy of a collage and post it or fax it to the client and then explain the colour with notes, but went through all those hoops. So I kind of left off the back of this college degree, and that's sort of my journey to discovering my aesthetic, but no real, I never knew how to read a piece of writing and create a piece of work in response to it, or listen to a piece of music, or answer a brief. I wasn't an illustrator, so it was quite a clumsy. I used to turn up on deadline day at the New Scientist magazine with five completely different collages. I'm so nervous, I didn't even write any of them. They're like, oh, we like these two, we'll decide later, can we keep these? I'm like, yeah, brilliant. And some are on wood and some are on canvas. And I kind of slowly learned how to just be comfortable with my weight. And I was very excited that I was going to get, illustration was a great way of getting a short fix to being a creative, getting a bit of money and then do the next one. So I couldn't handle the idea of having the big exhibition collage every year and hoping that it sold. I just really wanted to be this kind of fine art collagist, but get paid. This is jumping to only like 2 years ago. Just going to show a range of different ways that I appropriate collage and found material to create an overall image. Some feel, you know, highly embellished, highly decorative, but essentially everything kind of has to have a meaning. Even if it's just a little texture that has a meaning or a pattern. So this was for Nobu, the best restaurant in the world, and they've got branches everywhere. So we needed a bit of Reykjavik, a bit of Norway, a bit of Boston, a bit of Hollywood. All these kind of things had to kind of come together. But it's, you know, a short, I probably had about 5 days. And I had to use stock images for the people. If you're using contemporary people, someone took those photographs, they have to be paid for. They're not expensive, £5. So kind of, there is copyright issues with commercial collage. But a lot of the other stuff is gleaned out of old cookbooks, Visit Sydney, Australia, the ancient book of etchings of fungi and mushrooms. You could find all this stuff on the first 10 pages of Google, but all the other collage illustrators are doing that. I was lucky that I learned to research in an analog way before there was Google Images, but so it became a habit. I've talked way too much about the first 5 slides. So using texture and pattern to create, this is for British Airways, and they just wanted a beautiful, how long people have been observing the Royal Borealis. So once I did a very quick sketch, collage sketch, took a photograph, sent it to the director, and once he approved that way, it was just going to be this, putting lots of beautiful photo, colour copy textures together with a little guy observing it. Then it was just using all the time I had to make it as beautiful as possible before you'd say like 4 o'clock deadline. Which is great. Sometimes a solution comes an hour before that 4 o'clock deadline. Other times it comes early and you can spend more time honing it. Just to show kind of different ways, this was made purely with my fax machine. So I had these elements. He was the guy in the film, and I really like this idea that it's quite a dark psychological film where he's got three personas and there's a sort of ancient time loop in his head. But and the film slowly deteriorates to the end of this heinous ending. So I just thought the idea of refaxing it. So in the end I get this sort of 5 versions, which is just the finished piece, which is the fax paper. And they chose the one which was sort of in the middle of deterioration. So trying to, you know, use that, choose a way of working in collage that the medium would kind of reflect this kind of time loop deterioration thing going on. To do some branding, so a couple of bottles of whiskey. And again, that teapot had to be the right dynasty. It couldn't be Japanese if it was Chinese. You know, it had to be the exact right thing. So you've got to be on point with that stuff, because the chances are no one's gonna glance and go, those lilies are not from China, but this is our biggest festival. Is ridiculous. Things have got to kind of be right. But, you know, this is pure decoration, but it's underpinned to a concept of history, beauty, authenticity, all these words that random people give you when you get a brief. You get a colour palette, you get a template. And I probably could have done that in Photoshop, but I can move everything around on that collage in about 20 seconds and do five different, like, the shifts, the fish go there, oh, the fish there, you know. In Photoshop, it would just be like a nightmare for me. So it does take time to get it all out of the computer and cut it out. You know, say something like that was a bit of fabric it was a bit of a rug. So it was scanned in sort of that big, but it came that big on my collage. So I do like to, even though I might find things on Flickr archive, someone from the Estonian Institute has scanned in all of their rugs in New Zealand and they're online, and you just email them and say, can I use a bit of these rugs for a collage? Like, yeah. Things do come from places, real places. I'll talk about my research kind of methods. Purely digital collage, about depression. Again, once the client was sold into this idea of a beautiful disaster in your mind, but it's kind of, for me, collage is often through experimentation, discovering a little vehicle, and it's like, I do have traits that I've sort of become familiar with. One is using hands, so expressive. So they crop up a lot. Again, I did 100 collages for Guardian in 2008, all about how to write. There's a little book for all these types of writing. And this was, I wanted to do a typographic collage, type as illustration. And so many writers wrote to me and said, can I have that as a print and stick it above my workstation? Because it's what I say to myself every time I try to write a paragraph. There's quite a lot of writers that have that above their room. And again, all these letters were pulled out of old, largely out of old Victorian music scores. Beautifully ornate covers, and then just chopped out, and then noodling, futzing, fiddling about until it sort of feels like it sits right. But I'm not a typographer. Someone would laugh at that kerning, I don't know. Again, very simple collage created before the COVID pandemic, about corruption in the world, essentially. But I just like the idea of tearing the layers back on the planet. Only me and only you know now that that's Charlie Chaplin. I tried a lot of eyes in there, and Charlie Chaplin's eye kept coming in and going, if I get up, it would just make the whole thing a joke. And you could say, that's Charlie Chaplin's famous photograph without his makeup. But these are the kind of things that go in. I think this was all these are paid jobs, illustrations for magazines, largely magazines, which are called editorial. Are the good times that you hold in your mind as good as you remember them? Were things that as good as this amazing good time that you had 3 years ago? So it was an experiment where I just chopped it all up and really put it back together and disintegrated it. It's as simple as that, really. Again, the sketch for the illustration is on the right, and the finished thing is on the left. Amazing book of short stories. For a collage artist, I think, or for me particularly, I particularly love anything to do with the unfathomable limits of a human mind. Memory loss, disintegration, unbelievable anomalies, great feats of mental prowess, anything like that. And heads and hands I really have a thing about, but again, once the client is kind of on board with the idea of something happening with your sketch, then it's about. So I don't know if stripped back is more successful than more embellished. Or did I need to? Is there a need for everything on that? Probably not. And that's one thing that I really do still fight with myself. I have a sort of knee-jerk thing. If an idea isn't very strong, I have to embellish it to make it more interesting looking. But it's not the way. I think the hardest type of drawing, typography, collage, filmmaking, animation is really, really simple, pared back to nothing, but it can be the most impactful. And it's hard to do something very, very simple, that's what I think. So, yeah, I'm going to show you some very simple collages in this kind of set. I'll put this in for Andy to do his maps. They basically said, can you make a train out of maps? But the hard thing was finding parts of the world. First of all, they're really copyrighted, so you've got to be really careful. I did a lot of sort of reversing on photocopying, printing things out and the other way around. But finding things that could create the shape of the big fender, the smoke, the lamps. But again, once I used to have a picture of the, it's 2014, that is quite a while ago. About 6 years ago, I was asked by this guy to create a really intensive collage that looked like an ancient etching. He showed me these huge murals in LA. I was like, yeah, I can do that. I can do that. I said, yes, to anything really. But these were a real big departure for me to make. So I decided I would largely look and research etchings and drawings. And normally, my collage sort of pool is the history of sort of photographs from 1900 to now. But this, there were no photographs, it was all drawings. So I ordered, was on eBay quite a lot, different books of etchings, ancient botanical drawing books. And anyway, there was a series of four of these, and they were meant to just be murals in this weed shop in Miami. And I had an agent who sold rights to them for hardly anything at all, a few $1,000, and now he is the biggest OCB, just all products to do with weed on the planet. He's exploring the whole planet and not getting any things. But he's, he, you know, it's all, they're on vapes, they're on resins, on cream and weed chocolate and everything. But they were a real big departure for me as a collage artist to kind of try and make things almost look like a tapestry. So all the bits were cut out and stuck down and printed. And then I do magic markers over certain areas to sort of bring in the darkness. Then it got scanned into Photoshop in sort of four bits, stitched together and then given a bit of punch. And then he wanted his logo in, of course, somewhere. Oh, bring that one up right at the end. So off the back of that, I got asked to do these, which was quite a surreal 3 weeks. I made five of these for sort of quite plush fashion magazine called Garage, where the whole idea of the piece was virtual holidays into surreal fantasy realms. So you could go on a virtual holiday where you would observe Somali pirates having a sea battle with Venetian gondoliers. That was another one, but I won't put that one in. A sort of future past twisted reality, wanted it to mirror each other. So that's a collage. I don't know if I've got the, no, I haven't got it in there. But again, that was just me going crazy. Did five of them over Christmas about 4 years ago. Just to kind of show, I mean, is there a concept? Is it just me decorating until the deadline came again? Or I think I just had so much fun playing with these little realms of people turning up from different perspectives and angles. Again, it's sort of, I don't know if I could do that now. I'm sort of like, wow, I turned too much out of me, but it's in the folio. And then sort of switching to, again, essential stories, but they wanted something thinking about self and selfhood. Maybe how many types of people you present to different people. You might be different around different people. So sort of, and that was, I tried to do that. I tried to make a set out of matchboxes where there were three levels and I was going to photo shoot it. It just wasn't enough time, so that's a digital collage. But still really tried to make it feel, you know, that handmade. Increasingly, clients want everything digitally because the illustrators here, as you you know, needed to get permissions and stuff. And invariably, they asked me, can you animate it as well at the end? Just if it just twitches for social media, or if it moves, or it, you get asked a lot. So again, that's work I do for free for a magazine that's distributed in prisons. It's poetry and anarchy. it's in prisons and to some street vendors in Brighton and Bristol and places like that. So occasionally I kind of stumble across, again, a vehicle, a kind of thing in collage, whether it's self-invented or it came from somewhere that people, that becomes like a hit. You're like making pop music, it's like, oh, that's, can you do one of those? And I get asked, can you put Tony Blair in the middle of one for us? No, I don't want to dilute. That trope of this kind of spike collage elements does come up a lot in my work, but and then I realised, where did this idea come from? I think it's from this, but it probably isn't. But I think it, around this time, my daughter was obsessed with drawing that, and she drew it day and night for a week. And she said it was a fish, and I just couldn't work it out. I was trying to. What I realised it was, it took us quite a long time. It's the fish. It's the fish. Do you see that David Attenborough documentary where that puffer fish in one bay in Japan creates this beautiful nest out of sand in this giant shape just like that? It's like 3 meters wide, a tiny little fish. And he spends weeks doing it just at this particular time of year when the tide wouldn't wreck it, and it's to lure, or you know, a partner to lay an egg in the middle, that will be their new little puffer fish. But she saw that. I think it came from that. But you know, I do think that that because you are visual people, and you've been visual people since you were really young, you had that urge to be creative. Now, you've soaked up so many different things, and you don't even know where your ideas are coming from. They're all there. You're recording all the time. And I really believe that. So it's only when you look back. Like when I saw that decorated F in my old school book, I thought, wow, it's really interesting. I'll show you later how it kind of weaves into other ideas. So you know, you just have to dig about, find your ideas. I think they're kind of all there. The next set of images, I'm sort of looking at a project. The Photo Society, if you're an illustrator, you have to know about the Photo Society. They commission young illustrators to illustrate famous books in history. And they have competitions. They pay well. It is amazing. But it's a really nervy job to get. I got to re-illustrate Oliver Sacks's. I brought it in so you can see it. It's 12 illustrations. The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. and it already had a really massively iconic cover by Paul Slater, who kind of did the spin on the Magritte cover. Anyway, so I had to read it and then choose the places I was going to put the illustrations. They just said, big undertaking, really nervy, but I kind of, even now I can't read a novel pretty much without doing that to it. If there's anything interesting, I have to circle it in case I need to know it again, or just because it was so interesting. Or draw the line to the other bit in the novel, and I'm like, that relates to that, doesn't it? Maybe I've got a thing, don't know. Probably. But I brought that book in as well, the book I kind of destroyed I'm quite a physical creative, I think that's what it is, but I often find that getting physical with your thinking, then all your thinking, you can look back on it, it's done, you can see it. It's not sat there for 6 hours going, I could do this, I could do that, I could do this, I could do that, and you've forgotten all the could do's. Just probably past the best could do because you didn't get it out and get it onto paper. So anyway, I illustrated moments in the 12 stories. They're all about, you've got to read this book as well, short stories about people who have had massive, Dr. Sacks, sort of breakthrough psychologists, we've got another word as a doctor, but he helped people get over serious neurological conditions, people that will look out the window and see a bird, but their brain will tell them that that is a red hat. And that's how their brains work, and they operate in the world like that. And through interventions, treatments, not medical, not chemical, but he was amazing, he had some amazing breakthroughs, and there was a few Scorsese films based on this book. So these were the illustrations I did for the inside. Again, a gift for someone that likes making abstract collages, where meaning can be interpreted in lots of ways. So it's not being an exact answer in a piece of writing. But this, for me, was a really big, again, turning point in, and it gave me a lot of confidence to be weird, and paid to be weird, and have work that isn't necessarily obvious what it means. So I was like, right, now I can show clients roughs that are just a bit weird, and hope they'll go for the oddest, weirdest, most interesting abstract result, rather than going, the book cover's called Women in Black. I've done 12 different types of women dressed in black, you know, it's kind of, so they were like, right, okay, do the cover. It's called The Man Who Mistook His Wife. So I read the first story about a guy with a fascia. Basically, he tried to take his head off in a meeting with his wife's head off sat next to him. They said, what are you doing? He said, I'm just getting my hat. And that was the stage this guy was at with his realm. The book was named after that particular. And so I was very pleased. I just went away and I was really quiet. I had loads of time for this, all these 12 illustrations. I didn't have much else on. And I made this and I went, that is the cover, because it really embellishes all of the elements that are in that first story. How do you store memories? Do they drift away? All these other kind of things about claustrophobia, I don't know. And they went, oh no, no, it's too obvious. I was really like, oh, what do you mean? I just didn't say that, of course. And they said, we like this falling away. Can you just do something simpler? Get simpler, it's hard. I had fun finding all these bits. I was like, oh, there's so many different things I can put in there that have meaning in that first story. But after a few, I just got this little passport photograph, blew it up into photocopy, and I did that. I was like, shit, that's really interesting. I was nervous of showing them that, because is that book cover? There's been no writing on the cover as well. And they went, yes, just work it. So I did a lot of, these became before that. I should have showed it in a different order. But once I'd got this photocopy on a table, I've got my 45 degree right angle, it's a trade secret, ruler, and cut his head up to the left, flipped it over and cut out to the right. And then it all fell to pieces. And I was like, I'll give them a spray mat on the back of the paper before I came to pieces. So then I could turn it around because I really like that one. Let's get it on the scanner. So these are all these little things that you learn in the process of. So the result was this cover. And again, for me, it was like, wow, I've turned a little corner with collage, because I never thought I'd make sort of such an abstract kind of, is it fine art? Is it illustration? Graphic art. So again, this was really born out of experiment and born out of a good designer saying, go simpler, more impact. No. I can't remember what's next. I've got a few kind of things like this where I'm kind of looking at how the process is. Next project was some pub signs. And again, the research for these had to be really accurate. It had to be that soldier. That is the ship. I really wanted some flowers from the battlefield, from the Battle of Alma, before photography was invented. But using the internet as a tool, there was a heritage centre in New Zealand where a soldier had survived that battle, wrote his diary, pressed some flowers, died. Inherited down through the family, got given to this heritage centre. They scanned them in. I was like, wow, real flowers, but they were black, so I couldn't use it. But I found the right type of flowers and recreated it. But I like to become obsessed with a subject matter, because you've got to echo it. We're getting a brief about, it could be anything, you know, the brief could, might not be ancient something, it might be, you know, the Olympics. But you've got to kind of, even if you're not reading loads about it, just become obsessed with the nuts and bolts of that whole realm. You know, my ways of researching, quickly go on eBay and buy a couple of picture books, get them delivered the next day, like buy a 10 on. And instantly, rather than scrolling through the top 100 Google grabs or stock websites, or even going onto the particular Battle of the Alma website, just kind of can get a book from 1900s about embroidery for nothing. And you've got loads of stuff instantly there. This is if you're a photographer or you're someone that does line drawing, that's your thing. I think finding physical stuff that's not on your computer. A little pile of books for a project, just have it there, photocopy them out, spread the photocopies out. You can glance over, get a whole vibe of something. I did one, then they realised that's the sort of gubbins of how it comes together. I must be really working hard, because there's some links Africa there, I've just seen that. I'm surprised it's not a bottle of Beck's, really. That's kind of earlier on, you know. There are real things in there, real napkins, but then also I photocopy stuff and print stuff out. These tiles are from the outside of the pub. Things like that. You get the kind of idea. And I did one for the Penny Black Inn. I've not been for a pint in either of these pubs, but we quite like that. And working out the kerning. You know, these weren't typefaces. They were kind of, they looked wrong at first. To kind of choose a typeface that was chunky enough to get information in it, but not just a blob. Serif for beauty and heritage. So all these things. But now comes the point where I go, oh my god, all your kind of ideas and obsessions are kind of there already, because I'd obviously done this job when I was 11. Even down to the hanging grapes and various other surreal embellishments where I just got carried away and wanted to fill up the whole thing. So this is, I don't know if this means anything, but it was only the other day I was like, that really means something in my head. Or looking for the gold star. It has to be full to have the gold star, you know, probably not a good. Right, this was illustration for Baltimore, some scientific magazine, but essentially the article was saying, should plastic surgeons try and persuade women not to have plastic surgery? That should be their mission. Let's persuade every woman that comes in saying, I'm not happy, is to say, this is the last thing you should do. Because how much is psychology and how much is physical? What is... where does this decision lie? So it was really hard to sort of illustrate this idea that are you in a beauty, take the knife to, you know, who you are, that whole kind of thing. But this was an experiment with, all right, if I cut across the contour of a face, I could get depth rather than cutting straight. Just things like that. So that was the solution, but it kind of went through a lot of these kind of, started off with this actually, very first, when I was doing this kind of image. And then finding the right person is really important. But it's only two things. And I think that, again, it's kind of stripped it right back to just two things. A cliche, two cliches. Being a surgeon is cutting, so that's the number one thing I did. Beauty, a beautiful picture of a beautiful woman. Third, is flowers beauty. You know, it is important to embrace cliches, I think, because everyone has an inherent thing in their head of that's pretty, that's not, that's dark, that's scary. Everyone's roughly in that sort of remit of, you know, all of the kind of feelings in humans, no matter where you are, have that same you do have a set of conventions. So I start with cliches quite often and try and do sort of a cliche collage quite quickly, because then I know I can rely on that if I don't come up with something clever. I get that right. What the obvious thing would be to do this, just do it. And then if you don't get clever later on, at least you've got something to handle. So yeah, that kind of ended up like that. This is a commission, I'm going to talk about this very quickly. Kurt Schwitters was a German artist who was considered a degenerate artist in Germany and sort of ran out of Germany in the war and was in exile in the Isle of Wight, and he ended up in a tiny, weird, odd village in Langdale Valley in Ambleside, up in the Cumbria, not far from there. And he spent the last parts of his life, died in obscurity there, but he had made amazing collage work for us history, amazing sculpture. And he was sort of, he died there, really on his own. He'd just been recognised by, anyway, I'm going into it. I was asked to create an image to try and get money from the Arts Council in this big brochure campaign. And I just thought, anyway, the idea we came up with is that he must have had some bits and bobs in a case or a bag, or because he was a compulsive collector. I'm sure he arrived from the internment camp with a couple of bag boxes or something. And I had this idea that he would spill a suitcase out and everything was there. So this was the idea of this. But once they said that we love the idea, I got obsessed with sourcing little bits of ephemera from that kind of era. Fag packets to maps to bits of love letters and notes and stuff, all chopped up. And then I do kind of treat stuff again. I go back to that thing that I did in Germany where I rub oil into bits of paper because they become richer and you see both sides of the writing and things like that. And then I plucked, with permission from outside Kurt Schwitters Merch Bond Cottage, I plucked a crocus, because a lot of his work, sculptural work, was based around crocus, and his girlfriend at the time planted that bunch of crocuses. They still come back from 1948. Anyway, but yeah, just kind of showing, once the concept was there, I mean, this is highly decorated mental, I don't know, what is it? Is it illustration, is it fine art, is it graphic art? I don't know, but, and then, you know, little moments hidden in there of, I found this amazing little thing on the map, Sons of Windermere, because he's kind of, I think it was Wilson's or Windermere shop, something, but embracing the idea that he is a son of Windermere, because there's so many interesting stories about his time spent there, sort of standing up on chairs at the local farm, reading his crazy poetry out, people like, get off your mad German, you know, you sort of, very loved, and he used to paint pictures of local dignitaries, just portraits to make a few bucks. Anyway, I don't know what else to sort of say about that really, apart from once the idea was there, then it was just really having fun. And I was with a tweezers going, oh, I need to reveal that word. That could be really nice, all right? No, the hand's the wrong way up, and it's just insane. It can just be insane. Right? My friend's a photographer, he shot it, and now it's in a shoebox somewhere. So the studio has gone through many. My partner, my wife Jackie, is also a collage artist. We're quite surreal, we met, didn't quite believe.
You're a collage artist?
20 years ago, before we'd really got any work. But part of the studio is her, and she's my harshest critic. She'll come in and say, lazy. That's a lazy job, you did that before. Oh, God, I know. She's really good. She's a good art director. So she's kind of, we are cut out studio, is a tour, but she has her own practice. I'm not allowed to touch her stuff. But I do, but she's not there. That's it, tidy. Sometimes it's like that. When I did those mind-bending VR collages, I did five of them. That's one of them there. There were sort of three, all working on at the same time. I can't, I feel sick. I feel like I'm a weirdo when I look at that. I just feel like, how did I get that? So like 8 years ago, I don't know if I can sort of put that much into, you know, and it wasn't paid well, but it was a good chance to get my collage in a glossy fashion magazine, so just go for it. Because I started before, you know, all collage artists will have piles of bits. And because I was a commercial collage artist, I realised I had to catalogue the stuff. It's like, I've got all these bits of green stuff. I'm going to call that grass and stick it in this filing cabinet. And then as I got more jobs, more leftovers. But you won't exactly find what's in there. Some of the names are a bit dodgy. I don't even know what some of them mean, but it's all a bit of carry on camping as well. But it's kind of, it's what's good about it is it's not accurate. So whilst I'm looking for knitting patterns, I find something different that could be better. And that's the problem with a digital search, is you only really get what the bleeding brain links to your words that you put in. You don't get all the accidental finds, which, you know, when you buy a book on drawings of fungi from 1912, you get all the most amazing other fungi that you will never get on Google. 200 years of print, or 15 years of Google Images. And I like this analogy I read in the Kurt Vonnegut book. He makes an analogy of a human not being able to understand other dimensions, but I changed it to this, like, an online search for good collage material is looking like a sea view through a straw. Like, that's amazing, look, all this stuff. Just looking at written straws, and look to go to the library, go to the venue and take some photographs. it's kind of a little analogy you have. So those are those things, and that is a very nicely arranged one of those drawers. They're not like that. I like to brainstorm and create a shopping list at the beginning of a big project. Because if you're just thinking 1930s, Victoriana, that's no good. But if you write down, oh, shoeboxes, cigarette packets, maps, and you're giving yourself a shopping list of things to kind of find a particular one, and you're like, oh yeah, that's what it needed. It needed some fruit and veg. Didn't get that veg, into a veg or something. So part of his sack of books is Jackie's. But I get lazy. I sit in the front of the computer and I do Google search and I do go on stock sites. It's speed, it's quick, it's easy. But you're not going to find the weirdest, oddest, twisted, messed up gem or the great odd thing that you found on the way to find those shoes. Do you know what I mean? So having this, you don't get this tomorrow, but when I was on your course, equivalent, over in Leeds at your age, I did have piles of bits and just a few books lying around. I didn't know I was going to become a college artist. I think making your creative nest and wherever you are a minimal typographer is important. Kind of, and your laptop should just be slid in there. One little other tool than that. These are my laptops. So I did a huge 50-year timeline for Oxford Paediatrics Department. Oh my God, talking about not, I couldn't even spell paediatrics at the beginning of that job. I'm just about winging it now. But I realised I had all these books because I really like dark and twisted stuff, but all these books of ancient drawings of diseases are just brilliant. Whoops, flying away. So the last kind of, oh yeah, I have this book where if I cut out lettering from a record slip, I kind of have this book full of, again, it's, what was the reason for me keeping those leftovers, I don't know, but if I want a nice P or a gorgeous letter into something, I know where to kind of go, and it's quick, it's there. Just a habit of being a magpie. Getting quickly onto, it's very, increasingly, 25 years or whatever, I can sound so old, of making static imagery for print, my own work. I grew up constantly growing itchy, wanting to do animation. Yeah. Anyone says collage and animation, people say Monty Python's Blind Circus, David Gilliam's Sublime. But I don't want to do that. I don't like it in my way. It didn't fit with my thing. So in frustration of not being able to do animation, I started sticking bits of collage in the street, filming them, just dragging things around the studio. So the next So six really quick little bits of experiments in the studio is me kind of grappling with the idea of moving collage around. We look, studio's on the seafront, just the explanation of this, and that is a letterbox, a cardboard letterbox. And it was just doing that one day with that. This is real wind. Oh, the sound. I've got to find a man, I've got to find some back in the studio hanging on to that thing. That's all it is. But all these small little, it just went by, and said, remember by? Died, it's the first door, press the screen and record. I loved it. But you could kind of do a small amount of parameters and tools. Kind of just not to make an idea. I wanted to do a whole pop video of things, little bits of collage out in nature, being moved by air, water, electricity, fire. Anyway. So it's just 6 seconds, touch the screen and record, that's me. That's got legs, but it died there, and that was it. Very frustrating. You can see the current dragging. Yeah. And then just, this is called left-handed reversal of a Spanish bollard. Left-handed reversal of a Spanish bollard. And then I started overlapping. It's just kids that haven't touched the screen and record. So everything's on my phone. iPhone 5, still clinging on to. Every time I press record, there was some sound, in the studio. It's just simple, loops. So I kind of... It goes on quite a long time, but I just go layer. Narrative-based animation duo through kind of it just sort of happening through Griff having an amazing vision in seeing how static work can become a narrative and skills as a filmmaker to bring to my moment making. But we start off at the beginning of just sort of finishing off talking about some of this and amazing journey for 3 years making stuff for all these quite cool clients. I'm quite confident in our made-up way of becoming animated. So we start off by sitting down, listening to these gaps in the documentary and brainstorming. Well, I thought I'd show the title sequence of Love Fraud, which was our first. Chucked in the deep end, can you do 12 sequences in 3 months? Here they all are. But the title sequence, Griff, we had lots of moments that came after doing 12 minutes of animation for all of this guy's rip-offs. He ripped women up for 10 years kind of thing, and they followed him in this documentary. But he made these odd moments. And a lot of the themes in the moments were, sadly, people being lured into his trap with this promise of an amazing life with him. And then, ultimately, it just falls into pieces. Chris said, that's what we do for the tile sequence. Had no time for the tile sequence. Griff animated it in a week, and that involved changes and stuff like that, and or less. But there's one point in here which I wanted to kind of talk about very briefly, and kind of done really. But it's about blossoming and dying. And once we had that idea, we're like, okay, but also embrace the cliche. Cliches work. So, but what are the cliches of meeting someone? Right, it's marriage. It's love, it's rings, is it a diamond ring, is it, all of these things. So, built the beauty and the hope and destroyed it. That's Griff's kind of masterstroke idea in thinking and the sequence and the narrative. I think in moments he's, and then he weaves it together beautifully. But this is the title for Love Fraud. Experiment, keep it, that's what's important. That's to be delving back on the hard drives. If you can, do some handmade, have a sketchbook to do some things that you can physically go. No matter how small it is. That's it, really. This is going to show off and save some of this stuff for 4 years. It's quite amazing. We still feel kind of we're early in it as well, and we've kind of got a lot to try and try new things, move away from that maybe. I don't know. But, is that cool? I've just got a few others that are there, but are we cool? How long was that? Yeah, I'm all right. They were just.
How are you feeling?
I'm all right. There was just another clip to show you a completely different type of collage animation that we did. It's all one clip.
You're great.
I have no idea of time exactly. 3 hours or.
Wednesday.
It's Wednesday. We were asked to do a reenactment of a fight scene in 1946. So there could be no embellishment, no conceptual no metaphor in the collage. It had to be a reenactment of some really racist police beating up a black man and blinding him in 1946 on the bus. And we were like, oh my God, in lockdown. But we did odd photo shoots in the studio. I bought, get this stuff, bought a uniform. I became the bus driver. The two bad cops. I had a friend, to a black artist who became the victim. And we shot it all at Griff. Again, I find it hard to think in the sequence, the time. Griff created these small collages of moments, almost like a director making a storyboard. And then I went and sort of embellished it. So we kind of made the illustrations for this. But then I gave all the illustrations to Griff, and he came back with this, which is amazing. I think it's so departed from what I could imagine my work being. And but I just think it's like a kind of photo story stuff. I'm not very well versed in film. I haven't watched a lot of films, so I can't make comparisons to that. I just thought it was an impossible task to have this scene done, but then this is the institute.
Found out what was going on.
No, that was it.
Mr. Auld found out what was going on and at once forbade Mrs. Auld to instruct
any further. Where is that? Oh, it's the next one. I'm going to show you the one.
$695. Enough to start the kind of life he hadn't dared dream of before the war. Like the other 900,000 African American soldiers returning home from duty, Isaac Woodard had come to see this bright new future as his due.
And the bus driver tells him, boy, go sit back down.
The bus driver cursed him. Isaac Woodard cursed him back and proclaimed his manhood.
He just said to the gentleman, you know, you don't have to speak to me in that manner. I'm a man just like you. In other words, give me respect.
Military training and service turned a black man from the rural deep south with a fifth grade education into a man willing to say words that he knew could put his life at risk.
At the next town, he goes looking for a police officer to have Woodard removed from his bust. Woodard's kind of perplexed. He steps off the bus, and as he's trying to explain himself, the police chief brings out his blackjack, which is like a baton, but it's spring-loaded and it has tremendous force, and hits Woodard over the head with it.
A soldier aboard the bus watched as the officer took Woodard by the arm and forced him around the corner and out of sight. That is the last I saw of him, he would tell investigators a few months later.
I've done that for years. I've got two children, my wife doesn't take that long. Well, it swaps. Let's do that, but I like to try and accelerate into something, to get a long day on something. You can get loads done. I procrastinate loads by making films of people stuck to letterboxes. But yeah, I'm atrocious, really. I'm late for lots of things. I haven't got a capability of understanding time, narrative, or sequence. No, I'm not very good at timekeeping, not very good, but when we did have children, actually, everything did go, right, I have to do this work now because I have to be at home as soon as possible. And that really crunched everything to doing things early, finishing projects early. I'm always on time with deadlines and go the extra mile to try and make it as best as possible before the deadline was natural, I guess, to try and do good stuff. But, I have no idea in what time it is in the day. I like to turn an email off. That's a really good thing. Turn your email off if you're working in front of a computer. I turn all those things off. Just do like 3 hours work with nothing. That's a real simple one. That's really good. You get loads of that. I'm easily distracted. Oh, the grip is just like, yeah. So time management, not very hard to work. Oh, there's this book you can look at, and a little collage sketchbook, which I did quite a long time ago, so you can sort of see the bits, if you want to have a look. And the kind of way that I researched that book to do those illustrations is kind of here, if you want to have a look.
You're hanging around till about 5 o'clock, aren't you?
I don't know, you've got a bit of power, but anyone wants to shut. Wants us to look at the work.
Yeah, we'll take for lunch and then we'll come back for afternoon and do next week.
Is there any more questions?
Oh, we're going on the brain.
Yeah.
I think that was a pretty much an intense kind of visual experience, I would imagine. Raffle withdrawal at the end, I think, today. So we're more often thinking. So one more speaker. We're doing a job, lads, you're probably going to draw in. So what's happening this afternoon is speaker at 1:30, they're going to do a joint talk, I think, and then they're going to take the illustration students across possibly to the back Victorian. So for everybody else, we'll probably finish by 2:30. That's when we'll draw the raffle. Yeah? They're okay? Because I think it's going to be a... Wet their whistle!